from Rice University, where the undergrads are overachievers. It's general physics too. Today, modern physics, and the photoelectric effect. Dr. Stenson, also a top 10 list. And now, a man who thinks we should liquidate the university and divide up the cash. Professor Hafner.
Hello. All right, here we go. Last week, final two lectures of whatever this has been. Let's see, a couple things. We're doing modern physics this week. I am going to put out problems that are just practice problems. They're kind of like the homework. They are Canvas homework, but they're, I set the due date as June 1st and the value is zero because I can't make things due after Friday and I don't want to make you do these by Friday because I know this is a busy week. So, you know, just do those. If you can do those, you're fine for the exam. This last little week is very plug and chuggy. I mean, it's not easy. It'll be hard, like another topic, but it's not vector fields and right-hand rules and really bizarre stuff. So I think you'll be good with this week. So the point is I'm getting you some problems, but they're not things you have to do for a grade because that would be hard to pull off by Friday. Okay, so there's that. I didn't dress up for you today. I'm just wearing a t-shirt and it's useful for you because I hear that a lot of students have imposter syndrome, a thing called imposter syndrome, where you think you only got into the school on a clerical error and everyone's smarter than you and all this. So I want to tell you that's not the case. No one knows what they're doing. Everybody does stupid shit all the time, including the smart people in charge of the university. What is this related to my t-shirt? Well, here's the deal. It's really hot in here. We haven't had downstairs air conditioning for 3 weeks. It's been fine for the past 3 weeks because it's been cool. It's getting a little warm now. And if I had a nice shirt, I'd probably pass out by the end of the lecture. It's really hot. Why is it really hot, you ask? Why can't they fix the air conditioner? So here's the deal. The really smart people that run this university and the really smart architect was actually a famous architect. And the construction guys got together and realized we designed a house and the opening to the attic is too small to get an air conditioner through there. So they said, I know. Why don't we like put the air conditioner in after we frame the house and build the house around it. So that's what they did. Brilliant, right? So, you know, eventually air conditioners break and now we're just screwed. So, you know. So the next Magisters of Jones, let you know there's no air conditioning downstairs. No, I'm just kidding. There will be. What they gotta do is they're actually gonna cut the whole ceiling apart. They're just cutting massive holes in the ceiling to replace the air conditioner. So there you go. No one knows what they're doing. Everybody does stupid shit, including me. All right, so there's that. Hopefully that made some people feel better. Okay, so we're moving into modern physics. And speaking of people that do stupid shit, let's see. So in the late 1800s, people pretty much thought physics was done. This is the story you'll always hear. And everything we've been teaching you is about that old stuff. Mechanics, classical electric fields and magnetic fields. We say classical a lot. It's because we're talking about this time, late 1800s and before, when it looked like physics was done, we figured it all out and everything. But there are a lot of little things that didn't quite make sense. And that's what they figured out in like the very late 1800s and the early 1900s, quantum mechanics, relativity, all these things. And they realized, oh, it's more complicated than we thought. Okay, so it's popular to say that everything we teach you in freshman physics is wrong, right? So that's sort of stupid. It's not really wrong. It's just an approximation to reality. And you don't have to go to modern physics to realize that everything we've told you is approximation, all right? So there's approximations in classical physics. I can give a couple of examples just to enlighten you here. So we talk about early on in 125, when you throw a ball, goes through a trajectory, because there's a constant gravitational force down. Gravitational acceleration, 9.81 meters per second squared. Of course, it's not exactly 9.81 meters per second squared, but not only is it not exactly that value, but it varies as you move around, right? It depends on what's under you. the mass density underneath the ground varies, and that changes little g. In fact, there's one rice professor who made a lot of money with the oil industry because he figured out how to get a really sensitive gravitometer on an airplane and fly it around. And when you fly it around, you can make a map of what's the density of the Earth underneath. And you can make a map of where the oil is. So he made a lot of money figuring that out, how to do that in the 70s. And he had a beach house, and I got to go to some parties. So I loosely benefited from that even. So yeah, so little g is not constant, even as you move around. What's another one? Oh, well, the Earth is rotating. So all those kinematics we calculate, we're actually on a rotating frame. So that changes everything. I could go on, but I won't. All right. So there's many little approximations we've been making. It's not just the fact that it's all technically wrong because of quantum stuff. So the three big things that changed around the turn of the century, the big things in modern physics. One is when things get small, they get weird. Okay, that's the quantum stuff. Number two is when things get fast, they get weird. All right, that's the relativity stuff. We're not really gonna do those two. Right now, we're mostly focused on the fact, the third big weird thing, is that light is a particle and a wave. It acts like both. So far in this class, we told you that light is a wave. It's a wave of the electromagnetic field. You think of it as the electric field oscillating, and we could even write an equation for it if we wanted to. E in space and time is a function of x and t equals E naught sine kx minus omega t. Remember that? And you could plot it versus x and plot the electric field and like that. And it's moving along at 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. And you bought it. I told you that, and you didn't question me. At least not where I could tell. This is on, right? Yeah. So light moves along as a wave. But now we realize, actually, sometimes light acts like a particle. And it's just a particle moving along at 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. Well, you know, which is it? And the problem is, sometimes you see properties that make it look like a wave, and sometimes you see properties that make it look like a particle. In the classical time, before the late 1800s, most people thought it was a wave for the reasons that we studied. Okay, what did we talk about that made light have to be a wave? Let's think. It's not the speed. Particles and waves can move. And it wasn't even necessarily the frequency. Because you could think, well, a particle, if it's an elastic particle, could be oscillating. So it could have a frequency that it's shaking as it flies along. You could give a particle frequency if you wanted to. It could be spinning or something. That would have a frequency. But what is the one thing? Yes, maybe you said it. Superposition. We talked about how when you have two waves and they overlap, sometimes those waves can cancel. And sometimes they can add. So if you have two particles that overlap, you can say, hey, they can add. But you can have two waves. You can have two particles cancel. Right? Particles are particles. They can't, they're like conserved, as you would think of them, if they had mass or charge or something. So it's hard to imagine particles that cancel. So therefore, all of this stuff we saw with interference and diffraction, all that is evidence that light has to be a wave. If there's something where it looks like it might need to be a particle, that must be some incorrect experiment or some mistake or something. So that's the first thing we're going to talk about then. One of the first big things in modern physics is the photoelectric effect. We're going to try to get to the bottom of whether light is a wave or a particle. All right. So we're only doing really two topics in modern physics, the photoelectric effect, and then Thursday we'll do radioactive decay. That's all the problems are about. Okay, photoelectric effect. Effect is when a hobbit runs a cat. Oh, I'm sorry, that's the photoelectric effect. But the photoelectric effect looks like this, is you have two pieces of metal, like big electrodes, like this, and you have vacuum in between them, like that. All right. And you go ahead and connect them with a wire like that. There we go. And you just start asking yourself, what are the electrons doing? Okay. So to explore the photoelectric effect, we have to start getting used to drawing potential energy diagrams. So we've done a little bit of this. We know what potential energy is. We've thought about electrostatic potential energy. So if a negative electron moves near another negative near electron, it has a high potential energy. It doesn't want to do that, right? It'll fly away. If it sees a positive charge, like a proton, it will want to go there. Right? It wants to go there. So what we do a lot in this part of the class, when you get into modern, is you make plots like this. You just plot the potential energy on the Y, and you plot something on the X. If you move on in science, often there'll be an axis, and it's a little vague what it is. That's just something. Sometimes it's just because we need to draw it in two dimensions. Here, I'm gonna be explicit with you what it is. This is position. Sometimes it's a generalized coordinate, and you gotta read 10 books to figure out what it is. So let's think, what is the potential energy of an electron in this situation? The electron, one of the free electron charge carriers running around in this circuit. You might say, that's just flat. It actually isn't. Let's pick a level just to say something. Let's say vacuum. Let's just say the vacuum is there. And I've given a pretty good hint there that it's gonna go down in the middle. So why would the energy be lower in the middle? We can kind of think of it in terms of electrostatics. So this thing has a bunch of protons that are positively charged, electrons negatively charged. Some of the electrons are free to move around. That didn't really matter right now. But if you have an electron in here, it's happy because there's a proton in here that it goes with. They go together, right? And there's a bunch of them. And on average, the whole thing is neutral, okay? So the electron is here because it likes to be near that proton. So that's lower potential energy, right? You have to do work to get it away, to raise its potential energy. If you put it here and let it go, it would fly over there. So the electrons like to be in the middle because that's where the protons are. So what we say is then the electrons, their energy is lower inside the middle like that. And the energy is lower inside the middle like that. And so here's the vacuum level. Here's being inside the middle. You could also see it this way. What if you had all these things balanced, all positives, all negatives, all balanced, everything's happy, and then you move one of the electrons out here? What's happened? You've left this positively charged. What does it want to do? It wants to go back. This is high energy. You have to do work to get it up here, more potential energy. Let it go and leave it to its own designs. It'll run back over here to lower potential energy. Okay, so maybe you can now accept that the electron being in vacuum all by itself is high energy, but being with its positive charge is lower energy. This diagram is not really just because of electrostatics. There's also chemical binding and quantum mechanics are also reasons it wants to go in here. If it really just electrostatic, it'd probably be all curvy or something. But really we draw it like this. It's more than electrostatics, but you can see it just based on your electrostatic knowledge. Okay, so far, the shape of this curve hopefully makes you happy. Since this is also metal, you could think of it as wrapping all the way around, right? So it's the same metal, so an electron could wander, just like a free electron can wander around the circuit. It could wander from this side to this side, that's fine. But the main point is, it's higher potential energy to get it into the vacuum, okay? Let's see, now there's, so I'm gonna label this real explicitly for you. There's the plates, and there's the gap, and there's the plates. Remember this position, so I've roughly lined it up. All right, there's another thing we're gonna draw, and this gets into a little bit of modern physics, I guess, quantum mechanics, but we're not studying it deeply, I'm just going to tell you, is we often see like a little thing like this and like a thing like this. What does that mean? It's almost like water. You draw it like water, okay? So what's happening here is you have a lot of electrons and two electrons can't be in the same state. So they can't be at the same potential energy. So here, the electrons must be in different states at different U. So they fill the U levels. And sometimes you think of it as kind of like a liquid. These are just hash marks, you know, to say this is filled. If you really wanted to draw it accurately, you would draw little levels. You'd say, oh, there's one electron on this level. There could be two, right? Electron pairs. And there's another electron on this level. And there's another electron on this level. And maybe if we do our chemical bonding, there can be four and six, whatever. Okay? It's the electronic structure of the metal that dictates this. But really, it's a bunch of really little closely spaced levels, and it's like a liquid. A liquid is a bunch of little closely spaced molecules in a macroscopic scale. You can't tell that it's a bunch of little molecules, it's just a liquid. So we kind of draw it, you know, we just say it's this thing that's filling up this well. You know, we're almost getting sort of a mechanical analogy here. I mean, we are making a mechanical analogy. This is the high energy, this is like vacuums up here and dry. Electrons want to be down here in the metal, and they fill up to here. Okay, so two important sort of places on this curve are where the lowest energy electrons are. Some might be living down here in this level, but another important one is where are the highest energy electrons? And then there can be electrons anywhere in between. We're talking about potential energy here. And I've drawn the same metal on each side and everything, so it'll be the same levels on that side. Okay, let's see, we'll label these with variables soon, but not yet. Okay. So hopefully you're a little bit comfortable now with the idea of this potential energy diagram. Okay. Now we're going to draw another one. We're going to change it a little bit. We're going to draw it again. Here we go. This is a lot to absorb in one lecture. So if you've been cruising through this class without the book, this last little week will be a little bit rough. You may need to look in this book for this one, but maybe this lecture will be so brilliant, it'll get you through. I don't know, I doubt it. Okay, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna add a battery. Yes, here we go, and make sure I do it the right way. And we're gonna see if we remember enough about currents and fields and electrostatics and everything to know what's gonna happen here. So first you look at your battery symbol. You gotta know which side's positive. Do you remember? The long plate is positive, and this side is negative. And in terms of circuits, you want to remember, what does that mean? What did we do to this circuit when we put a battery in there? We put this one, this is a metal, constant potential. We put this one at high potential. And we put this one where? At low potential. You know, if we had an EMF, you might say this one's at 0 volts, this is at EMF volts. But we're not even being that specific right now. We basically just raise the potential of this one and we lower the potential of that one. What do we mean by that? We mean the potential energy. We mean U, big U, right? So big U was Q times V. So if you have an electron, then we're raising and lowering the energy of those electrons by doing work, by cramming more charge on there because of the chemical reaction in the battery. So now let's try to draw that with our potential energy diagram and see if we're smart enough to do it. I don't know. It's got to be close. Okay. In addition to raising and lowering, well, let's see. Let's start with that. The metals. We're changing the potential energy of the electrons. And they're going probably up and down. So which one went up? You'd say, oh, this one up because it's higher potential, but they're electrons, they're negatively charged. So when we were introducing all this stuff, can you explain the fluid aspects of the electrons again, why they fill potential? No, I can't explain them. That's like years of quantum mechanics. I'm just telling you to accept that. The electrons can't all sit at the bottom of the well. They have to separate and they fill up, and there's so many of them filling up, you can think of it as a liquid. Or if you just want to think of it as a squiggly line with hatch marks, you can do that too. A liquid just is a fun way to think about it, because they fill up as though you poured a liquid in there. But yeah, no, the reasons are deep stuff. All right, so higher potential for electrons means lower potential energy, actually. So we're first doing circuits and charge carriers. I said, just pretend the charge carriers are positive. It doesn't matter. Well, now we're getting more real. We actually have to acknowledge that we're dealing with electrons here. So since we're dealing with electrons, here in this metal, it needs to come out at higher energy than here at this metal. So you got to ask yourself, do I understand that? Right. You understand that because here, lower potential, U equals QV, right? So U and the Q is negative and the V is negative, so it's a higher U. Okay, so in the diagram, we simply draw that one higher than that one. That's all we got to do. And now the vacuum is still, of course, higher because it's like if we apply this potential, all the electrons don't just fall out of the vacuum. And they're still staying into the metal, so it still goes up. But now, what are we going to do with the vacuum level? Are we doing anything special with a vacuum level? Let's also think back to our capacitor work. What happened between these two electrodes if they're big and close together in almost parallel plates? Yes, we had an electric field between them, right? If they're really close, you can say it's a uniform electric field. It doesn't really matter right now. What do we know about the potential? Well, in a uniform field, it would go down. It was like uniform, I mean, potential, like potential surface was a plane, that doesn't matter. But the main point is the potential goes, well, here it goes from high to low. Well, the potential energy of an electron, if it's going from high to low that way, is going from high to low that way, right? Low potential, electric potential, means high potential energy for the electron. So what that means is the gap is no longer flat, the vacuum gap, now is going to go kind of down like this, like that, pretty much. These should be the same height, but whatever. Okay. And what about the electrons? They're going to fill it just like they did before. So there's some electrons in here, and there's some electrons in here. Oh, forgot to make the waves. There you go. So that's our new drawing. So that's not so bad. You understand that, right? Negative potential lifted this one up, positive potential pulled that one down. They're different. This line has to do that. It actually matches everything you learned in electrostatics, right? Potential going down, electric field, well, potential energy of the electron going down this way, potential going down that way. Oh my God, I drew that the wrong way. Oh, there goes the lecture. So everybody probably thought they understood until I drew that the wrong way. Yeah, high potential means electric field goes this way, a little imaginary positive charge character would fly that way, but electrons would fly this way, higher or lower energy. Yeah, make clear, this is the energy of an electron. In every drawing, we're only thinking about electrons. I just lost my audio. Let's see, can anyone hear me? Let's see, I think you can.
We can hear you.
Change something real quick. Second, I assume somebody is texting that they can hear me. One second. But I feel better when I can hear. So everybody is saying we can hear you. Okay, so I'm not going to be able to hear. So if suddenly you can't hear me, figure it out. Or yell at me or start timing. Okay, let's keep going. Here we go. That's it. Everybody's thrilled. I can sense it that you're thrilled. Okay, so this is the setup of this experiment, and that's good. But here's what happened, is this got interesting around the turn of the previous century. What happens when you shine light on this? That's the photoelectric effect. So the way that light behaves is the interesting part. So we're gonna do is we're going to go through the four experiments of the photoelectric effect, and we're going to see how you try to explain them with classical physics. and see if it makes sense. All right, we'll speed up a little bit. Okay, so we're going to draw these diagrams now. I'm not going to re-explain the diagram every time though. So experiment one. It's always funny when you describe this centuries later, you make it sound like, oh, we just laid out these four experiments and did them, and then never explained it like that. Let's say we're going to shine light waves on the negative plate. Which, by the way, is the cathode. Some of your homework might mention cathode. The positive is the anode. And current flows. And it's proportional, the current is proportional to the light intensity. So you may remember that's the just how much light there is. Watts per meter squared was how we described light intensity. I think we got to that. So the experiment basically looks like this. You got your two plates, you got your battery between them, and you shine light, and I'll draw light like that. A wavy line coming in with an arrow hitting the surface. This is light, because we know light's a wave, so. And when it hits the surface, an electron, or electrons, I'll draw electrons circle with a negative. They go that way. So what does that mean for current? Well, current goes the other way. I know, it's confusing. Blame it on Benjamin Franklin. He was a flawed man. And current goes that way because electrons are going that way. But the point is, you get a current, okay? So let's think about our energy diagram now. Do you all feel like you're ready for the big stuff? Okay, get ready. I'm not even gonna draw the axes. Oh, you're not ready for that. Never mind, I'll draw the axes. That's too much. I don't wanna push you too far your first day doing this. I'll draw you. Here we go. We'll do this. We'll just draw that X. Energy of the electrons. I won't even draw the horizontal axis. How about that? So let's see. Here's a metal, and it's filled up like that. So there's just a bunch of electrons occupying a bunch of states. All right. And here's a metal, a bunch of electrons occupying a bunch of states. And if you don't have any light, nothing happens. Right, so take the light away. It was just two pieces of metal at different potentials due to a battery. Who cares? And you can kind of see why now. Is this electron, even the electrons at the very top that have the most energy, don't have enough to go over that barrier. So they're never going to go here. Right? Current looks like electrons flowing from here to here, but they can't get over the barrier. So that's it. But what happens is the light is coming in and giving the electrons enough energy to get over the barrier. And now we have electrons going downhill. Okay, so let's see, light shines a negative plate. So here's what's happening is light gives electrons energy to get over the barrier. We'll call it the vacuum gap. The vacuum gap barrier. I'm trying to be descriptive here. So if you look at this diagram, you can see, got to get over that. Got to get the energy from somewhere. So light can give it to you. All right. And if we were to plot, we said the current that flows is proportional to the light intensity. So we can make a graph here of how much current are you going to get, meaning the current in amps versus the intensity in watts per meter squared. And what they find is it's just proportional. Okay, so here you go, zero goes like that. More light, more current. More light, more energy dumped into the electrons, more electrons get over the barrier and they flow around. Okay. So does this shake the walls of classical physics in 1900? No. So classical looked at this and says, that's cool. Light has energy to give the electrons more light, more electrons over the barrier. So there's nothing about this observation that doesn't work with classical physics. Totally fine. Got a barrier going over it. Somehow the light basically heats up the electrons, just like when light heats up your hand. It's just shaking the electrons and giving them thermal energy. Perfect sense. But so that's experiment number one. Experiment number one is fine. No problems with experiment number one. Let's look at experiment number two. Okay. It's really the same experiment. It's an observation. Okay. There is no time delay between light on and current flow. So if we were to plot now our shots with the same setup, now plotting versus time, and I can't hear again. I think I'm just going to give up on my phone. I think my phone died. Yeah. So just comment a lot if you can't hear me all of a sudden. So there's no time delay. Yeah. So here we're going to plot the intensity watts per meter squared. And here we're going to plot the current in, you know, amps, something like that. It's good. Okay. So we plotted all that and function of time, and light on goes here. Well, we're going to plot the light, right? So the intensity is zero for a while. The current is zero, and you turn it on, it goes like that. And the current immediately turns on, right? So there's no time delay between the light coming on and the current flow at all, even at very low intensities. Okay, so you may say, well, I mean, that's okay, I guess, because light's a wave and the wave starts heating it immediately. But what do you know about heating? Right? It takes time. You know, if you shine light on your hand to heat your hand doesn't immediately get hot. It takes time to heat things up. Or if you're using, you know, a radiant heater in the kitchen or something, things don't heat up immediately. They take, you have to put the energy in, and there's a whole thermal balance, and it takes time. So what do the classical physicists say about this one? They say, it should take time. And if it's really just heating in sort of the classical sense, depending on intensity. So lower intensity, it should take longer to heat up those electrons up and get them over the barrier. On intensity. So that's weird. So they say WTF, right? And what they meant back was, where's the filibuster? That's what that means back then. Why don't we have this delay? Where's the filibuster? I recently learned that this thing, this question mark exclamation point, is called an interrobang. I just think that's a really cool name. I never knew that. Experiment two actually can't be explained by light waves. Turn the light on, instant current. Strange. No explanation for that one. Let's look at experiment three. I'm curious if anybody knew that it was called an interrobang, and if you did, let me know, because I think I'd never heard that in my life, and I've been alive for a long time. All right, experiment three. There's only four, so it's okay. Experiment three, here we go. Let's see. Light makes current, fine. There's no delay, weird. Here's another one. The current, it's the same experiment. Current
requires a minimum a frequency of light. A current requires a minimum frequency of light. Oh, this person knew about interrobangs, trying to promote the normalization of their usage. Oh my God, you can type one. Okay, here's showing how to do that. I had never seen them on top of each other until this morning when I learned about them. I'm all upset about the order. Does the order depend on context if you can't put them on top of each other? Okay, let's move on. Current requires a minimum frequency. This is the big one. This is the one where you say, what? So frequency of the light is like the color of the light, right? So you can have red, you can have blue, you can have UV, you can have X-ray, near IR, whatever. Same setup, but now let's plot the current versus the light frequency. And we'll put it in hertz, even because I'm not going to put you numbers, so it doesn't really matter. But you get no current until you reach a certain frequency, and then you're fine. Then you get all kinds of current. F naught, we'll call it. Okay, that is a very important thing that needs to be labeled quickly. So if we're plotting as a function of frequency, this minimum in hertz is called F naught. Okay, so you have to have at least F naught frequency of the light to generate any current at all, to knock anything over the barrier. And there's always an and on these. It depends, F naught. F naught depends on the metal. So you can do this with gold and silver and aluminum and iron and sodium and potassium and all those other things that are metals that you never heard of, or you didn't think they were metals. I thought they were salts. So let's see, how is the classical physicist going to explain this? Well, also minimum frequency of light and also intensity don't even matter. Just to turn the knife a little bit. What that means is, even if you're just below this cutoff, you can crank it as high as you want and you're not gonna get any light. You can hit it with a huge amount, you're gonna get nothing. So with classical physicists, what does he say? He or she, you know, classical, probably he. Classical says the wave pushes electrons to heat them should happen at any frequency. It really shouldn't matter. It should really just be, you know, the amplitude. I mean, there may be some dependence on frequency, but there should be this case where if you're like, this hertz, you're knocking at all kinds of electrons, and if this hertz, you're not. Right? It's a very slight difference in the wave properties, slight change in frequency. It's a very sharp effect. So they say what WTF, and they meant by that why the F naught. That's what they meant. All right. So that's number three. So the first one, classical could explain, and the next two, two and three, can't explain. Doesn't take any time, happens instantly, and there's a critical frequency problem. All right, this next one is gonna get confusing, okay? But we're gonna do this next one, and then we'll take the break and we'll explain how it works after. We're gonna go to experiment four. Experiment four, what we're gonna do, remember there was a delta V, there was a battery in there. So let's draw it again real quick and remember what was going on. We haven't drawn our diagram in, you know, a few minutes here. So there was a battery here, like that. And in our diagram, we plot U, this is the positive side, the negative side, but for electron energy, remember that's electrons energy, this is high, and this is low, like that, and our vacuum level looks like that. And we're filling up our electron C here.
Okay. This is the normal thing we were doing. So this is a very weird experiment, weird observations. I got to think of what else could we do, right? So we could mess with this. We could adjust this applied bias. And you could think, well, do you really need the applied bias? What is it doing there? And it kind of depends on how much energy these electrons are getting over the barrier with. You know, are they just barely making it over? Are they getting this much energy and just flying over? It depends. That tells you whether or not you need the battery. Like, what if you don't have the battery? Then this is flat, right? Then you knock an electron out, and maybe it can be on top of the a barrier, but it might just fall back because it'll electrostatically be attracted back. So that's the idea, that if this is flat, you do need this potential once they're over to keep them going downhill. But what if you hit them really hard way above the flat barrier? And then they would just keep going. Like when they're high in energy, that means they have kinetic energy. So you bump them up and they have some kinetic and they can make their way over. So this diagram gets confusing. We called it potential, but then we start drawing it and implying there's also kinetic. I know, it's annoying. Okay, so I mean, what happens is you bump it up to here in terms of its potential. And then when it moves here, it's losing potential, so it must be gaining kinetic. So if you bump it hard enough, it has plenty of energy to make it all the way over, even without the bias. Okay, so here's what they did, is reverse the battery. Okay, reverse battery still allows current to flow. And I'm going to say photocurrent. Okay, so I just realized that doesn't make any sense. If you reverse the battery, you still get this light-induced current up to a stopping potential. So we're obsessing with this experiment because this concept of stopping potential is important once we explain what's really going on. All right, so stopping potential, and what's basically happening is, let's imagine we're going to reverse this and keep, we're going to say, what if we reverse it and make this positive and this negative, but still shine the light on this side? Basically, instead of shining the light on the negative electrode, the electrons want to jump off, we're shining on the positive electrode. So would we still get this effect? So now this is the high and this is the low. I'm going to draw it from down a little farther here. Sorry, and like that. That's what I'm trying to draw. All right, electrons. So you can say, well, they're never going to go over now, but it depends on how much energy they're getting from the light, right? If you hit it with, if it's getting enough energy from the light, the electron sitting here could go all the way up to here, and then it can get over the barrier. Okay, so just because you reverse the bias doesn't mean you get no current. And if you plot, here we go. So let's plot the big stopping potential plot. This is confusing the first time you see it. Don't worry, you'll survive. Let's see. So this is, we're plotting the delta V from the battery. And here's 0 volts, okay? So normally we had it like here. This is normal. Normal bias where you're shining the light on the cathode. Right, and you said, okay, so you get some current like that, right? Shine light, you get current, photoelectric effect. You turn down the bias and you're adjusting those levels and you get less, but it doesn't actually go to zero, right, like that. So you can still get a photoelectric effect even with this thing not here. You know, if you knock electrons off with enough energy, they'll make it all the way over there. It's just the bias helps them make it over there. So all that happens is, you know, no bias, electrons still make it, but less. Okay, that's what's going on here. All right, and then you go reverse bias, they still make it up to a point. Okay, reverse, they still make it across up to a point, delta V, right? So if you you reverse it strong enough, then you get no current. You basically dialed the current to zero. But basically what's happening is you're making this so big that they just aren't getting enough energy to get over. Right? So that's why eventually it goes to zero. So you have curves like this. And if you change the light intensity, they do this. This is low intensity, this is high intensity. So this kind of matches what we thought about or saw before, is you raise the intensity and it goes up and down. But when you reverse bias it, you eventually drive it to zero. And what's weird about this, okay, so now we've got the whole point. This is a very long, bizarre description, but why does this bother the classical physics people? That's what you want to ask. So classical, who think of light as a wave, say, okay, we can see this. I mean, you know, the wave is heating, the electrons giving them a certain amount of energy. Sure, if you make the barrier too high, they can't get over. But they would ask, why is V stop, called the stopping potential, V stop the same for all intensity? You would think that if you have higher intensity, you're heating the electrons up more. That's why you get more current. You should be getting them higher here. If they were higher here, they could get over a bigger barrier, and the V stop should be back here for the higher intensity. But no matter what you do, you always have the same stopping potential. You're basically just, the stopping potential in simple terms is just measuring how high are the electrons going in energy. That's really all it is. If you get the bias high enough, you kill them all. So that's how high, that's how much energy they're getting. For some reason, they're getting the same energy regardless of the intensity of the light. All right. So they say WTF. So for the person that likes interior bangs, all the ones I wrote down, why is that fixed? What does that WTF mean? Why is that fixed? I do question mark. Exclamation point, terabangs. That's what I've decided to go with. So there you go. The classical physicists cannot explain it. So after the break, I'll tell you the solution. Maybe you already know. All right, so time for the break. 10:27, I'll see you at 10:30 dose. From the home office at Jones College, it's time for the top 10 pandemic memories. Let's get started. Number 10, the pandemic is not over. Yes, we must still be careful. In some parts of the world, it's still horrible. But my hope is that next year, at least higher education will be much better than this past year. So let's look at some memories from this past year. Number 9, the moment I realized I looked better with a mask on. Number 8, experiencing zero traffic in Houston. Number 7, critiquing people's home offices and Zoom background choices. And related to number 7 is number 6, creeping by pinning. We've all done it. Number 5, so much CNN. Number 4, zero alcohol transports. In 100 years, I would never have guessed we would have zero alcohol transports for a whole year. Number 3, how hard can it be to make Lysol? Number 2, we all went a little cuckoo, and the number 1 top 10 pandemic memory is teaching physics 125 and 126 was surprisingly unchanged. All right. I'm sorry I left you over the break, wondering. You know, your whole world has been rocked. We clearly know that light has to be a wave. You saw the interference effects yourselves. And now I've told you about this thing that happens that has to be a particle. It's rough. I hope you're okay through the break. So how do we resolve this? And Einstein figured it out, right? So Einstein's view. Another little fiction that we always tell is that one person figured it out. It's usually a bunch of people figuring it out over many years. But this is what Einstein proposed, and this is actually what he won the Nobel Prize for. It wasn't actually for relativity, it was for this. He just did so many things at once that they said, I don't know, give it to him for that. Is it can all be explained if you assume that light is made of discrete particles, which you have probably heard of, called photons, right? Photons. They're also discrete. They don't really interact much. They're small, they can't talk. And for my fellow grammar nerd there, these are homophones, but what's it called when both homophones make sense in a sentence? I don't think that has a name. I think we could name it. So let's talk about that later. Gotta think of a good name. I don't think we can top Interrobang though. That's hard to beat. Duo homophone? I don't know. Let's see. So light is a photon. So what does this mean in terms of kind of describing the properties of light? So let's see. Well, what would higher intensity mean? Normally, that was sort of the energy being carried by the wave in watts per meter squared. So for the wave, it was watts per meter squared. For the photon, what is it? It's just more photons. Number of photons per second per meter squared. It's not a unit we're gonna use. I'm just giving the idea, okay? Higher intensity, more photons per second crossing some area, okay? What about the energy? So the idea of energy, we didn't do it a whole lot in waves. You basically take the amplitude and square it to get this this intensity in watts per meter squared. It's technically the irradiance, but whatever. Here, each photon has energy. And I'll say discrete again. It's not spread through a wave. Each little localized photon is carrying its own punch of energy. And here it is, the energy of the photon is HF, which brings in a new fundamental constant of the universe, Planck's constant, okay? So H is Planck's constant, or Planck's constant, if I want to be highfalutin, 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34. You're going to enjoy doing that with your calculator. 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds. Okay, so that's a constant. It'll be on the formula sheet. You'll get used to using it. You probably won't actually because we're going to do it so little. And F is the frequency in hertz. Okay, so this is the MKS value for Planck's constant. You might see it in EV and other things, but we'll get by in this class just using the MKS value. You might see it with a bar. There's a 2 pi involved, don't worry about that. Okay, just use H with F for this class, and there's H, and you'll be fine. All right, so that's the energy being carried by each photon. It's in joules. Okay, we'll convert it to EV in a minute. I don't want to write that down right now, but it's in joules. So let's do a quick diagram then of what's going on. There's our two electrodes. There's the battery. And just like before, we said light is coming in. And before I drew those waves, so now I'm going to draw gammas moving like that. Gamma is usually the symbol for a photon. And often you actually still draw a photon as a wave. because there's wave-particle duality and the photon does act like a wave sometimes, but just to make it clear, and I want this diagram to look different, is that we have particles, gamma particles, that eject the electron. And the electron goes across and you get a photocurrent, all right? But here's the key. Photons knock out electrons one to one. So a single photon knocks out a single electron. So that's the whole reason of the way we're going to explain all those experiments. Yes, if a photon came in with like a huge amount of energy, yes, it could knock out multiple electrons. But we're talking about a level of energy of the photon where it's just the right energy to knock out one. We're not getting into multiple knockouts. Okay. So this is an important equation. So that's one you'll be using a lot. Right? The energy of a photon, how does it relate to the frequency? Another one you use a lot when you're dealing with photons is we might give you a wavelength instead of a frequency, because it's much more common to talk about light in terms of wavelength. So you'll also need to use that along with C, the speed of light is the frequency times the wavelength. So we say light of wavelength 500 nanometers. What's the energy of the photon? Okay, you'll have to convert it to hertz. You're really annoying. And then you put the hertz in there times H to get E. If you want, you can do your substitution, right? You can say it's HC over lambda. That's fine too, if you want to do it one step. But this is just a reminder from the waves part of the class, how frequency and wavelength are related. Okay, so now what we're going to do is write a brief sentence explaining each of the four experiments. So we're going to go back through our notes and look at the experiments, but all we're going to write down is explaining how it worked. And then we're going to look at how we do problem solvings a little bit. All right, let's see. So let's see how Einstein explained everything. Experiment one was not controversial because we just said, oh, well, you know, the light has energy, it makes more photons, or it makes more electrons. So instead of the wave giving more energy, you just say more photons, especially since it's one-to-one, more electrons. Because it's a one-to-one thing. So twice as many photons, twice as many electrons. What was experiment two about? That's where we started to run out of, problems. Back in your notes at experiment two, the issue was, what was it? Let's see, experiment two. Experiment two was the one, right, the delay, yes. I actually forget, right. The delay. There's never a delay. As soon as the light hits, there doesn't need time for this wave to heat the electrons up, like it takes time for a toaster to heat up your bread. It's instantaneous. It's like you put the toaster in and you turn it on, instant toast. That would be cool. We need a photon, whatever. So experiment two, the first photon, 2 arrive, knocks out an electron. There's no need for it to wait in this description. It's really taken the idea that rather than the energy being distributed through space evenly, it's in little chunks, right? It's very concentrated in a particle. So when that particle gets there, it's got all of its energy, rather than have it spread out into something that might get spread over many electrons. So the light's energy all from one photon straight to one electron. So that's enough energy to immediately knock one out. Now you might say, what if I turn the intensity down so low? How low is it? What if I turn it down so low that it's like one photon every minute? Then yes, you would have to wait a minute, okay? But the idea was, in the classical view, even if the intensity is low in the sense that there's still billions of photons per second, which there are, in the classical sense, that would be an intensity where you'd have to wait. But in the photon sense, there's always photons showing up. So we're not talking about low in the sense of all the way down to, you know, photon per second or photon per minute. That's ridiculous of them. See, that's experiment two. So again, it's really the one-to-one thing. As soon as a photon arrives, then you've got an electron. Okay, experiment three is the big one here. If you looked at this in high school, this is the one you focus on. You probably didn't do the stopping potential. The photon, so that was the one where there was a minimum frequency. When you're right below this frequency, classically, you should get the same effect pretty much as being right above this frequency. But they find that if you do this as a function of frequency of the light, it goes down and there's like a minimum. So the photon, or there's not a line down, it just suddenly stops. The photon needs minimum energy to knock the electron over the barrier. So now we're going to be advanced and fancy here. We're going to draw it real quick. It's going to be wild. We're not even going to draw the electrodes or the axes. We're just going to draw that. And you're going to say, I know what the, oh, good Lord. So if I'm going to draw it correctly here, and it's going to go like that. And you're going to say, I know what that is. That's a couple of electrons with a battery between them and thinking about the electrons. So the idea now is this photon comes in, can give it a set amount of energy. And if that set amount of energy is that big, then you get electrons. And if it's bigger than that, you still get electrons. And if it's bigger than that, you still get electrons. But if it's smaller than that, as soon as it goes below the height of that barrier, no more electrons. So that's the reason, or that's how photons can explain it, is because they're discretely carrying the energy. Experiment four is the confusing one, but you know, we have to have homework problems, so it's not the reason. So experiment four was the stopping potential. That's when we reverse this. Okay, here's one way to reverse it. So let's just send the photons over here. All right. And you say, well, how could we possibly work? It's the barrier still the right barrier doesn't matter. What if we give the photon gives you that much energy? Then it's gonna go over. What if it gives you that much energy? It's gonna go over. So the stopping is a way that we keep doing this to measure, you know, it's a way to measure sort of how much energy is. How much energy are you giving them with a the photon? That's what you're measuring. So the problem is I was varying the photon energy. So let's say we're going over and the photon is giving us that much. Just seeing the current doesn't tell you how much it is. Because basically, electrons are getting a huge amount of energy, enough to get over. You don't know how much energy they're getting. So what you do is you start turning this up until the barrier goes right past that energy height. And then you get nothing. That's essentially what the stopping potential is doing. It's a way to measure how much energy is each photon giving the electrons at whatever frequency the photons are at. You can think of it as a way to measure the photon's frequency. So let's just say that V, I've confused myself, so I'm just gonna write out exactly what I have here. V stop depends on electron energy. This is the explanation for particles. Which does not depend on intensity. Yeah, so yeah, moving this up and down, when nothing makes it anymore, it depends on how much energy they're getting from the photon, right? That depends on frequency, but not intensity, which is exactly what we saw with the stopping experiment, right? So. You go below a certain frequency and then it works, but it doesn't care about the intensity, right? So in that sense, it's kind of like this one, right? You've got to be at a certain, I'm sorry, this one. You got to be at a certain frequency, intensity doesn't matter, okay? So these are all sort of related, kind of seeing similar things over and over, just with different experiments, okay? That's the photoelectric effect. That's the basics. And that was one of the early experiments that told us that something weird is happening, that light is not just a wave. Light also is a particle, or sometimes behaves like a particle. And so really the case is, what we found is that this what's called wave-particle duality.
So depending on what kind of experiment you're doing, light can behave like a wave or it can behave like a particle. And it doesn't mean that the light is changing in mind. It just means that it has properties that the way it physically works, it can look like both depending on what you're doing. It's really a particle whose chance of seeing it somewhere is distributed with a wave function. So that's how it can be a particle, but it can still interfere. Right. So we're not getting into all that. What we want to do now is look at this diagram and see if we can get some equations around the photoelectric effect that we can use to sort of do problems and think about. And we're going to define a few terms here. So let's look at some predictions that Einstein would make now that we know all this. And let's simplify things down a little bit. Let's look at this metal vacuum interface and think about these energies and define a few things. So here we're plotting again, we're plotting our electron energy versus position. And it's just, we're not doing the whole setup now. We're just looking at the metal and the vacuum level there. Okay. So just like before, let me draw that a little lower, I need some room here. Just like before, the electron is at lower energy when it's nice and happy and in the metal. And just like before, the electrons fill up all these levels. Just something looks like that. So here's our electrons. Some are way up here at the highest energy they can be at the metal. Some are way down here at the lowest energy they can be at the metal. It's a distribution, okay? There's the vacuum there. And we're talking about electrons jumping up into the vacuum level. And maybe they get to another electrode, okay? So what we would do is we'd define some things here. So one, we'd define E naught. That's an energy. It's called the work function. So you will see the word work function in problems. What is the work function? Or this is the work function, calculate that. So it's the work function. It's the minimum energy to remove an electron. So let's see if we can draw it on our diagram here. Where is E naught? The minimum energy would be from the ones that are at the highest energy already to get to the vacuum level. So it's between there and there. There is E naught, the work function. It's how much work you have to do to get the electron out of the metal. All right, so there's E naught. Different metals have different work functions. Okay, depends on the metal, right? So gold, the work function, we give them an EV, their energies, but we give them an EV. Gold is 5.1 EV. Sodium is 2.75 EV. And to see the rest, you gotta buy the textbook. That's how we sell the textbook. Or you can find them anywhere on the internet. But there's a little table, and that's the source of the work functions for the homework problems in the book. I think in the Canvas homework, you do have to know a couple work functions, but you can Google them. They're very standard. Or you can email me and ask me, what's the work function of graphite? Actually, don't ask me the work function of graphite, the normal metal. Okay, so another energy we define is here, ED, all right? That is how deep is the electron in its energy well, or in this little fluid, okay? How deep is the electron? Okay, so you might say that it's this whole height, but it's actually not a constant. That's like the deepest it could be, okay? E naught is a constant, the work function is a constant, because that's from the top to the vacuum level, because it's defined as being from the top. But ED could really be anywhere in here, okay? So that's an important difference. The work function is defined as going from the top of the highest electron level. ED can go to a variable level deep, so it could be any value between zero and the maximum ED, whatever that is, okay? ED is sort of an intermediate variable we use a little bit. It's not like a fundamental important thing. This is like a fundamental
property of metals. This is just intermediate thing. Okay, so what happens in the photoelectric effect?
What we're gonna do is we're gonna conserve energy. So this is kind of the basic equation.
What happens?
Photon comes in, boom, and it knocks out an electron and it gives it energy all the way up like to here. And that gets it into the vacuum. And then maybe it can go off and make a current, okay?
So the photon energy has to add up to all these things, right? The height of this,
this is the photon energy is here. This is how much it gave this electron.
So we have to say it's equal to ED, how deep it was, plus the work function, plus whatever extra it gave it.
And this we call the kinetic energy.
Right? Because it has to be kinetic because this is all the potential you can get. So if you give it enough energy to get it right to here and then you give it more, it's got to be kinetic. There's nothing else it can be. So that's where these diagrams become a little bit potential and kinetic. This is where the diagrams get a little bit not just like a plot. You plot a proper plot of the potential energy, but then you draw things on it that include kinetic energy, right? That can be confusing. What's reference graphite? Oh, it's not really a metal. It's a semi-metal, so it's a zero gap, semiconductor, blah, blah, blah. Don't worry about it. That's why graphite was the worst thing to ask. Okay, so HF, so let's conserve energy. That's the photon energy. It's equal to how deep was it below the Fermi level? That's a special name for that level. It's convenient to be able to refer to it as something. So I don't know if your book identifies the Fermi level, but that's what we call it. Because obviously it's an important energy. So ED, how far below the Fermi level was the electron that got excited? Plus the work function, how much does it take to get it from the Fermi level to the vacuum? And then the photon might not have stopped there, might have had even more.
Plus, how much kinetic energy did it give the electron?
So that formula can be used for a lot of the homework, right? There's questions like, send in a photon with a certain wavelength, and it excited an electron right from the Fermi level. And here's what the metal was, so you know the work function. How much kinetic energy did it have? Right, you'd take your HF, you'd figure out the energy of the photon. You'd say it was at the Fermi level, so the depth energy was zero. So you take that energy of the photon, you subtract off the work function, and the remaining energy would be the kinetic energy. So there's some little problems like that you can do. Pretty straightforward. What gets a little trickier is stopping potential problems. Okay, we have 4 minutes. So what I'm gonna do now is give you a hint on doing calculations except for stopping potential. We'll do stopping potential Thursday. But there's one more thing you need to know is in problems like this, you could just be asked like, what energy of a photon does it take? What's the minimum energy it takes to get an electron out of gold? And what wavelength of light is that? Something like that. So the minimum it takes to get an electron out of a metal is basically its work function, right? Because you assume you're getting one from the Fermi level, not all this ED thing, and you assume you're barely getting it out. So K equals zero, right? So an example, this isn't really a bullet for the notes, but a problem would be like, you know, what wavelength to get an electron out of, say, gold, right? So how would we approach this? You'd say in this case, ED is zero it would be worded in a way, say, what's like the minimum energy photon or something like that. So ED is zero, and you're barely, I'm gonna say barely. This is worded better when people aren't making it up off the top of their head with 2 minutes, okay. So ED would be zero, K would be zero. You just barely squeaked it out. So you're basically just saying that the HF of this photon equals the Fermi level. Okay. I mean, that's basically the equation. And then you'd say, okay, but then doing this problem, is what I want to give you some advice, because what have you got here? You've got this in joules and you got this in EV. So you're going to have times where you need to convert from joules to EV. Okay. So the energy, and I'm going to put joules here. You divide it by the charge of the electron, 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 equals the energy in EV. Okay, so I'm just letting you know that's a conversion you need to make. Is that right? Minus? Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And you'll find typically the EV work functions we're dealing with are like a few EV. And when you go calculate the actual joules, you're going to find, yeah, they're sort of 10 to the minus 19 joules. So those 10 to the minus 19s kind of cancel, and you get the prefactor of this one prefactor, and you get kind of something around unity here. I mean, it might be 5, but, you know, less than 10. Okay, so this is just a little bit cumbersome, right? This is 10 to the minus 34. This is like 10 to the 14. So kind of a mess, but it all works out. I just want to remind you that you do need to convert between EV and joules. With that, you can do like half the problems. We just need to go a little farther to talk about the stopping potential Thursday. Or we actually don't. Okay, so I'll see you Thursday, and we will talk about this a teeny bit more, and then radioactive decay. And then we'll be done.